Hi everybody. In the previous video, we saw how we can calculate changes in entropy from pressure volume diagrams. In this video, we're going to look at how we can find absolute entropy based on thermodynamic quantities that we can measure, and how that relates to the third law of thermodynamics. In order to do this, we need to think about the temperature dependence of entropy. At this point, based on the two previous videos, we have a sense of where entropy comes from a microscopic standpoint, and we can calculate changes in entropy in reversible paths of a pressure volume diagram. So that puts us in a position where we can explore the links between entropy and temperature. The big question here is, how does entropy vary as temperature changes? When you first learn about entropy in general chemistry, you learn sort of a vague idea that entropy is a measure of disorder, and so you might guess that entropy is going to increase as temperature increases. It turns out that's going to be correct, but we can be more quantitative about it. As we know from the first law of thermodynamics, a differential change in internal energy is going to be equal to differential amounts of heat transfer plus work. Internal energy is a state function, so this is true no matter what path we're talking about, but we're going to look at a reversible path because it's easier for us to track changes in energy. We can then use the definitions of entropy and pressure volume work to rewrite a couple of these terms. We know that a differential change in entropy is defined as delta Q reversible over T, so we can rewrite the term delta Q reversible as TdS. We also know, based on our definition of pressure volume work, that we can replace delta W reversible with minus PdV. Now we can take all terms in this equation and take partial derivatives of them with respect to temperature at constant volume. If both sides of the equation were the same before, then we can take these derivatives and know that both sides of the equation are still going to be the same, and we have these three terms in the equation. The last term is going to go away. The partial derivative of volume with respect to temperature at constant volume is going to be zero, because at constant volume, the volume doesn't change, so that just leaves us with two terms. And notice that the left side of the equation is our definition of constant volume heat capacity. So we can say that CV, the constant volume heat capacity, equals T, the temperature, times the partial derivative of entropy with respect to temperature at constant volume. And if we swing around the temperature term, we can say that this partial derivative of entropy with respect to temperature at constant volume is equal to the heat capacity over the temperature. So this means we know the rate at which the entropy changes as temperature changes. And notice that both constant volume heat capacity and temperature are always going to be positive, which means this partial derivative is always going to be positive, and entropy is always going to increase as temperature increases. This is what we expected, but now we can be more quantitative about it. This is the equation that we just found, and it pertains to constant volume conditions, and without deriving it, I can tell you that we can write a similar equation at constant pressure conditions. The rate at which entropy changes with changing temperature at constant pressure is going to be equal to the constant pressure heat capacity over temperature. So these two equations are analogous. One of them applies to constant volume, and the other applies to constant pressure. So let's think about where we are. We just found an expression for the rate at which entropy changes as temperature changes. What that means is that as long as we know the heat capacity, either constant volume or constant pressure, depending on our conditions, as long as we know the heat capacity in a temperature range that we care about, that means that we can find entropy differences. All we have to do is integrate the expression that we just found. If we want to know how much entropy changes from temperature 1 to temperature 2, we just need to integrate the derivative of entropy with respect to temperature, which, as we said, is heat capacity divided by temperature, over the temperature range of interest. So we have these two analogous equations that apply to constant volume and constant pressure conditions. While we won't work a numerical example here, you will have some opportunities to practice this. So far in this video, we've still been talking about changes in entropy, and I promised you that we would talk about absolute entropies, so that's where we're headed now. As we just said, we can find a change in entropy from one temperature to another by integrating the heat capacity over the temperature. That means that, in principle, if we knew the absolute entropy at absolute zero, at 0 Kelvin, then we could find the absolute entropy at any temperature just by integrating the heat capacity over temperature up from absolute zero to whatever temperature we're interested in. The reason this is important is that the third law of thermodynamics tells us what the absolute entropy is at absolute zero. This idea originally came from Nernst and Planck, and yes, this is the same Planck that we learned so much about in quantum mechanics. And the idea that's now known as the third law tells us that at absolute zero temperature, a perfect crystal has zero entropy. So this term, the entropy at absolute zero, actually goes away because it's equal to zero, and we can say that the absolute entropy at any temperature T is just equal to what we get when we integrate the heat capacity over the temperature up from absolute zero to whatever temperature we're interested in. Just a quick note about this equation, you'll notice that inside the integral we have these T prime terms, and I don't want you to get confused by those. We've just introduced a new name for the temperature variable so that we can distinguish it from the temperature that's the bound of integration. Since we've already seen Boltzmann's entropy formula, we can make some sense of the third law of thermodynamics. We saw previously that absolute entropy equals the Boltzmann constant times the natural log of the number of microstates. And remember, this W, the number of microstates, is basically the number of different ways that a system can have a given energy. That means that when we're thinking about absolute zero temperature, when all particles are in their energetic ground state, there's only one way of achieving that energy. So W equals 1. And because the natural log of 1 equals 0, the absolute entropy would equal 0. It turns out that the third law isn't quite always true, because it assumes that there's no degeneracy, so we'll actually see some exceptions in the next video. But for the most part, for our purposes, we can say that a substance has zero entropy at absolute zero temperature. Okay, so we have a general approach to finding the absolute entropy. We can integrate up from absolute zero, the heat capacity over the temperature. But there are important situations in which this approach breaks down. And I want you to think for a few seconds about what these situations might be, where we can't actually integrate the heat capacity over the temperature. The situations that I'm referring to are phase transitions. When you think about a phase transition, the melting or boiling of a substance, there's an amount of heat that's taken in by the substance that goes toward not changing the temperature, but actually allowing the phase transition to happen. What that means is that phase transitions are essentially spikes in the heat capacity, cases in which the substance takes in heat with no change in temperature. So that means we really can't use this equation to find changes in entropy that happen during phase transitions, and we're going to need another approach. To figure out how much the entropy changes during a phase transition, we can remember our definition of entropy, dS equals delta Q reversible over T. During a phase transition, the temperature doesn't change at all, so we can change the differentials to deltas in this equation, and we can say that delta S of a phase transition equals Q of the phase transition divided by T of the phase transition. These subscripts TRS are used for the textbook to refer in general to phase transitions, so this could be fusion or melting, or boiling or vaporization. It's really any phase transition that we're interested in. And we've seen that at constant pressure, which is usually the set of conditions we care about, we can equate Q at constant pressure to delta H. So, delta S of a phase transition, the change in entropy, is equal to delta H of the phase transition, the change in enthalpy, divided by the temperature at which that phase transition happens, so the melting point or the boiling point. The reason why this equation is useful is that it's usually possible for us to look up delta H's of phase transitions. The backs of textbooks will tabulate enthalpies of fusion or enthalpies of vaporization, and we can also look up melting points and boiling points. So, based on data that we can usually find for common substances, we can actually find the change in entropy during a phase transition. That means we now have basically all the pieces we need to find the absolute entropy of a substance at any given temperature, as long as we're given the appropriate thermodynamic data, like heat capacities at all temperatures, and the temperatures and enthalpies of phase transitions. If we want to find the absolute entropy, what we basically need to do is just add up all the contributions to the entropy that come from changes in temperature, and also the phase transitions. So we would have a general equation that looks something like this, which I realize looks pretty scary, but we can break it down. So in this equation, we're looking for the absolute entropy of a gas at a given temperature, and we're assuming we're looking at a substance that has typical phase transitions, where it starts at a solid at very low temperature, and at some temperature it has a transition to a liquid, and at some higher temperature it has a transition to a gas. This equation is basically just adding up all of the relevant terms. The first term tells us that we're going to integrate from absolute zero to the temperature at which the substance melts, the heat capacity of the solid divided by the temperature. This is the contribution to the entropy that comes from heating up the solid. Eventually, we reach the melting point, and then we have to add in the contribution to the entropy of the melting itself. That's going to be the enthalpy of fusion divided by the melting temperature. Now that the substance is a liquid, we can then add in the third term, which comes from heating up the liquid, where we integrate the heat capacity of the liquid over the temperature from the melting point to the boiling point. Next, now that we've reached the boiling point, we add in the contribution to the entropy of boiling itself, which is the enthalpy of vaporization divided by the boiling temperature. And then finally, we integrate the contribution to the entropy of heating the gas up to whatever temperature we're interested in. We integrate the heat capacity of the gas divided by the temperature. Again, I realize this equation looks kind of scary, but it's basically just adding up all of the relevant terms in the entropy that come from heating up the various phases and also going through phase transitions. So now we have the basic ideas that allow us to find the absolute entropy of a substance at any temperature. But there's still one last practical challenge. We often don't actually have calorimetric data at very low temperatures. In other words, we often don't have heat capacities very close to absolute zero. So the last thing that I'd like to talk about in this video is the fact that we can address this practical problem using an idea called Debye theory. According to Debye theory, the heat capacity of a substance at very low temperatures, below, say, 15 Kelvin, is proportional to temperature cubed. So we can use this idea to find the entropy of a substance at very low temperatures. We said that heat capacity is proportional to temperature cubed, so we'll say heat capacity is equal to some constant K times temperature cubed. We know that the entropy of a solid at low temperature is what you get when you integrate up from absolute zero to the temperature that you're interested in, heat capacity divided by temperature. So if we substitute in our expression for heat capacity from Debye theory, we have an integral from absolute zero to some low temperature T. We can take out the K because it's constant, and we can cancel out the temperatures, so that now we just have an integral of temperature squared, which we know how to integrate. And we find that the entropy at some low temperature T is equal to KT cubed over 3. Since we define the heat capacity at low temperature as KT cubed, we can replace this and say that the absolute entropy is equal to the heat capacity over 3 at low temperatures for which Debye theory holds. So what does this mean? It means that if our lowest temperature data point is, say, 15 Kelvin, we can estimate that at whatever that lowest temperature data point is, the absolute entropy at that point is the heat capacity at that point divided by 3. Even if we didn't really have information at lower temperatures than that. So, Debye theory allows us to estimate the absolute entropy at whatever our lowest temperature data point is, and then from there on up, we can do our usual process of integrating and adding in the contributions of phase transitions. Finally, just a few takeaway messages from this video. First of all, assuming there are no phase changes, we can find the change in entropy with changing temperature by integrating the heat capacity over the temperature. We saw that the third law of thermodynamics tells us that a perfect crystal at absolute zero has zero entropy, which means we can find the absolute entropy of a substance at any temperature by integrating up from absolute zero. And finally, we saw that when phase changes are involved, the entropy is discontinuous, and in order to find changes in entropy, we have to know transition enthalpies and the temperatures at which phase transitions happen. That's all for now. In the next video, which will be our last one in the series about entropy, we're going to look at how all of these ideas play out for the entropy of atoms, molecules, and reactions.